Welcome to St. John's Virtual Church and to our service of morning prayer, Rite 1, on this third Sunday of Lent. Wherever and whenever you are joining us, we are grateful that you have chosen to worship with us today. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us humbly confess our sins unto Almighty God. Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us. Spare thou those who confess their faults. Restore thou those who are penitent, according to thy promises declared unto humankind in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of thy holy name. Amen. The almighty and merciful Lord grant you absolution and remission of all your sins, true repentance, amendment of life, and the grace and consolation of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
O Lord, open thou our lips,
and our mouths shall show forth thy praise.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy.
O come, let us adore him.
O come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us heartily rejoice in the strength of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and show ourselves glad in him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hand are all the corners of the earth, and the strength of the hills is his also. The sea is his, and he made it, and his hands prepared the dry land. O come, let us worship and fall down and kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is the Lord our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. O worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Let the whole earth stand in awe of him, for he cometh to judge the earth, and with righteousness to judge the world and the peoples with his truth. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy.
O come, let us adore him.
The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows his handiwork.
One day tells its tale to another, and one night imparts knowledge to another.
Although they have no words or language, and their voices are not heard, their sound has gone out into all lands, and their message to the ends of the world. The law of the Lord is perfect and revives the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure and gives wisdom to the innocent. The statutes of the Lord are just and rejoice the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear and gives light to the eyes.
The fear of the Lord is clean and endures forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether.
More to be desired are they than gold, more than much fine gold. acceptable in your sight. O Lord, my strength and my Redeemer.
A reading from Exodus. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, and you shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourselves an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of their parents to the third and fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. For 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work. You, your son or your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, but rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God has given you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Let us say together Canticle 5, the Song of Simeon. Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace, according to thy word. For mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people, to be a light to lighten the Gentiles, and to be the glory of thy people Israel. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
A reading from the Gospel of John, chapter 2, verses 13 to 22. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days? But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. I don't need to tell you that we are living in the midst of disruption. So much of our lives have been overturned in the past year, from the mundane small things to major things, from our daily routine and how we have to navigate going out into public and the decisions we make about who to see and how to see them, how to talk to one another, how to greet one another, to the more major things. So many of us have experienced either illness ourselves, or we've had loved ones who have gotten sick. Some of us have lost loved ones. And those huge disruptions can totally reshape the course of our lives. But I also don't want to discount the smaller ones. The ways that our routines and rhythms, how we move through the world, has been challenged, overturned, how we've had to rethink everything. And while there is loss in that disruption, I think disruption can also have a clarifying quality. That we can, when we can no longer just go through the motions, it forces us to consider who we are and what is important to us. And I think that challenge, the challenge to consider what is important, is one of the things that Jesus is inviting the people of his own time to consider in our gospel reading. He and his disciples go to the temple on the Passover with thousands of other pilgrims to perform their religious obligation and duty, to offer sacrifices at the temple. And when they get to the gate of the temple, what they see is not what they expect. You know, instead of this holy day, this day of religious devotion, when the love that God has shown God's people and the love that they show God back should be on full display, should be at the heart of it, what they see instead is religious transaction. They see the money changers at the outer gate willing to change Roman money into temple money. They see these pilgrims taking that temple money after a cut has been taken out by the money changers further up to buy the doves, sheep, and cows that need to be sacrificed in order to fulfill their duty and obligation. What Jesus sees is this religious institution at work, devoid of the spirit that once animated it. He sees the letter of the law being followed, but not the spirit. Those sacrifices were meant to be a show of gratitude, of thankfulness for the abundance that God had given God's people. Instead, they had become a burden, an obligation, detached from their meaning. And it's that reality, the transactional reality that Jesus sees before him, that brings up his anger, that leads to him overturning the tables of the money changers, driving the sheep and oxen out from the temple gate, and to challenging the religious authorities of his day. By doing that, he wants to call them back to rediscover a zeal, a love, a passion for God, a closer relationship with their Creator. We don't get the rest of the story. We don't hear what happens after this moment. And we don't ever hear it from the side of these money changers and those selling livestock. I wonder what happened to them after their livelihood, their way of being at this Passover festival had been disrupted, interrupted, literally overturned. What do they do after Jesus is done speaking, after him and his disciples leave? Do they just go back to the way things were? Do they set their tables back up and start trading again? Or do they pause to reconsider? Do they take in the words of Jesus and ask themselves why it is that they are doing what they are doing? I wonder if there were some of them that maybe just walked away. They realized that this tradition, this simply just doing things the way that they had been done, was no longer working for them. That maybe what God demanded of them was something new. Our tables have been overturned. We haven't gathered in this space in a year as a community. We've had to find alternative ways to be together, to come together to communicate with one another. We're still in that immediate aftermath of our tables being overturned. But as we look towards the coming days, weeks, months, years, we've got some decisions to make. What does our future together look like? In the aftermath of everything being turned over, who are we going to be? Who is God calling us to be? Will we just try to go back to the way things were as if this year had never happened? To resume those comforting and familiar patterns? Even though we've seen their limits, we've seen ways that we can be a church community, that we can be the body of Christ in a more expansive way? Or will we ground ourselves in our tradition and open ourselves up to the future, providing opportunities for new forms of expression, new forms of community life, new ways of listening, understanding, discerning, and meeting the needs of our community and our world? Disruption and disturbance are a huge part of ecological systems. I think of the Western landscapes in which fire plays such an important role. And while fire is destructive, it destroys, it kills, it can sweep an understory clean, it also provides opportunity for new growth. I've had the pleasure of hiking through a fire-scoured landscape 1 or 2 or 3 years after it had burned, and it's amazing what comes up. All of these new nutrients are accessible to plants. All these seeds that had been buried in the earth are given the chance to spring to life. But the ecosystem that is created after the fire will not necessarily look like the ecosystem that came before it. The distribution of species changes. The flowers of different colors spring up. It's the same location, but a different habitat, a different ecosystem. I wonder what our ecosystem will look like. I wonder what ways of being the church will return, but also what ways of being the church we will discover anew. This time of disruption gives us an opportunity to rethink how we embody the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, how God's love is speaking to us, within us, and through us, how the institution of the church can rethink its mission, how we can focus not just on getting back to doing things the way we have done, but the ways that the love of God can shine through us in new forms. Our reading today ends with the promise of resurrection, new life that is distinct from the old. Jesus talks about the destruction of the temple, but is also talking about his own body, his own death, and his resurrection. His resurrected body is not like his old one. Resurrection is not about returning to life, but is about achieving new life. Jesus' resurrected form is an altogether new thing that, yes, has through lines that come through from his earthly life, but is something more. And I think that's our invitation today, to be resurrected. And while we may not know exactly what that looks like, I think there are some questions that we can sit with, little seeds that can be planted that may spring to life once the fire has passed. What new life is God calling us into? What new expressions of God's love are taking shape within us, within our community? How will we not just try to wind the clock back, but transition into new ways of being the body of Christ, expanded ways of being the body of Christ? How will we take what is good and beautiful and holy about our traditions and share them more broadly and widely with the world? How will we continue to be agents of God's love here in St. John's, on the seacoast, and in all the places where we live and move and have our being. I leave you with these words of Jesus. Destroy this temple, and in 3 days, I will raise it up. Amen. Now we reaffirm our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. O Lord, save thy people and bless thine heritage.
Govern them and lift them up forever.
Day by day we magnify thee.
And we worship thy name ever, world without end.
Vouchsafe, O Lord, to keep us this day without sin.
O Lord, have mercy upon us, have mercy upon us.
O Lord, let thy mercy be upon us.
As our trust is in thee.
O Lord, in thee have I trusted.
Let me never be confounded.
Almighty God, who seest that we have no power in ourselves to help ourselves, keep us both outwardly in our bodies and inwardly in our souls, that we may be defended from all adversities which may happen to the body, and from all evil thoughts which may assail and hurt the soul. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. O God, you have bound us together in a common life. Help us, in the midst of our struggles for justice and truth, to confront one another without hatred or bitterness, and to work together with mutual forbearance and respect. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O God, who hast made of one blood all the peoples of the earth, and didst send thy blessed Son to preach peace to those who are far off and to those who are near, grant that people everywhere may seek after thee and find thee. Bring the nations into thy fold, pour out thy Spirit upon all flesh, and hasten the coming of thy kingdom. Through the same thy Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I invite your prayers of intercession and thanksgiving, either spoken aloud or in the silence of your hearts. We draw these and all of our prayers together in the words of the general thanksgiving. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, thine unworthy servants, do give thee most humble and hearty thanks for all thy goodness and loving kindness to us and to all people. We bless thee for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for thine inestimable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we beseech thee, give us that due sense of all thy mercies, that our hearts may be unfeignedly thankful, and that we show forth thy praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to thy service, and by walking before thee in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen.
Welcome again, everyone, to St. John's Virtual Church. We are so grateful that you're with us. A few quick announcements is that one thing is that we have had an incredible pledge campaign this year. It is ongoing, but so far we have 221 pledges on our way to 300 pledges, which is our goal. And we have $491,000 on our way to our goal of $500,000. So first and foremost, thank you. It is so encouraging and indeed humbling. If you have pledged, thank you so much. If you have not pledged yet, there's always time, and no gift is too small or too large, but thanks again. And now Nathan is going to share with you what's happening later today.
This evening, we continue our Lenten series on guides in the wilderness, journeying with the saints through Lent, with Dr. Liza Anderson, who is an assistant professor of church history and ascetical theology at St. Scholastica College. And she'll be sharing with us about the desert mothers and fathers and the tradition of spirituality that emerged in the early centuries of Christianity and some of the faith practices that helped them deal with the challenges of their time and may help us deal with the challenges of our own. Please join us on Zoom at 5 p.m. and then we will have Say Compline together over a live stream at 6:30. The links to both of those will be in your e-news.
And now let us walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Let us pray together a prayer of St. Chrysostom. Almighty God, who has given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplication unto thee, and hast promised through thy well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, thou wilt be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, the desires and petitions of thy servants as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of thy truth, and in the world to come, life everlasting. Amen. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you with those who you love this day and forevermore. Amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.